or to this computer. Everybody have a good weekend.
Yeah, no. Busy.
Everybody have a bad weekend?
I'm in major mourning.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
I've
had a death in the family.
David, sometimes we don't get your humor.
Yes, I lost. I had a death in the family.
Oh.
Okay, gotcha.
They got the Buccaneers too.
Okay, you guys can hear me okay though, right?
Yes.
Okay, good. Let me shut off my little background back there. We got a lot of content, a lot of stuff to talk about this morning on here. First thing I got from one of my investors, what's giving me this trouble this morning here? From one of my investors, I got a, anybody like success stories?
Yeah.
Sure. Yeah. I have an anonymous investor here who gave me, let me share my screen here. And where is that? Oh, look at this. How many people here would like to make $32,860 a month?
Wow, me.
This is one of my investors, and this investor just shared this with me. Wanted to remain anonymous, and I don't blame that person. This is through real estate. This is rental income. This person started out with one property, reinvested it into other properties, and now there's a passive income of $32,860 a month. Can you live on that, David Skolnick?
In California. Yes.
David yes, cannot live on that. Okay, sorry.
Yes, I could. I was muted.
Oh, okay. I like success stories. And if anybody ever wants to share your success story with me and reveal yourself or remain anonymous, we love seeing that sort of thing. Absolutely. How many people? I was on a keynote this weekend. I put it into the Skype group. It was the Los Angeles Real Estate Club. And I'm going to share with you today my keynote, or some of you call it a PowerPoint presentation. I think it's really important to market yourself, to get your message out there. The wonderful thing about this keynote, it was supposed to be 60 minutes. It turned into 2 hours. It was live on Zoom, which seems to be very popular now rather than in-person. I like in-person presentations. I have an in-person one. I think, what is it, David, in March in San Diego?
I thought you said it was May.
Is it May? Okay, it's May. I schedule a lot of different speaking gigs, either on Zoom or with the pandemic and everything, not everybody likes in-person anymore, but I have one in May in San Diego. Why do I do that? Why is that important?
Get yourself out there.
Get yourself out in front of the crowd. What happens when you get yourself out there? Give me some more.
People remember you.
And?
You have the opportunity to close sales.
Say that again, Alex Wolsick. I'm sorry, we didn't hear you. Or maybe not. Okay.
Just for those of you who haven't seen Claude live, he role plays with an entire audience.
Do we have fun?
You have a hard time doing one-on-ones role playing, he does 1-on-300.
Yeah, we have so much fun. I think what's the worst thing in the world? I've always been mesmerized by people who could get in front of an audience and just speak like they're talking to their best friend in the living room. I've always been amazed. How do you do that? Okay. Because I used to be dreadfully shy, and going through life being shy and sitting in the back of the room and not making, it's not really that great for business or
building
anything.
A brand.
What was that, Jessica?
I'll actually vouch for
building
that.
A brand.
I remember those days.
Oh yeah. I had some good people help me. Great book to read. Speak and Grow Rich. Was one book. Toastmasters is wonderful. If you want to build up your confidence and be and be relaxed in front of a group. Toastmasters is wonderful, and it's not even expensive. It's like $25 to join, and you get to practice in a room with other people who have the same problem you do. Okay, there was a time I couldn't speak in front of two nuns and a Boy Scout, okay? And through practice, you learn how to do this, and it's great for marketing. It brings you in deals, buyers, sellers. You have to be your own, remember the show Mad Men, you know, about the advertising agency in the 60s? You have to be your own advertising agency. You have to promote yourself. If you're just waiting for the phone to ring, you know, you're just, it's going to be a long wait until you make money. We have to be very proactive in this. Let me see. So I did that on Sunday, an actual presentation. I'll show that to you in a minute. I had one of my old friends came on today, early this morning, and he said, "Claude, what do you do?" He's a realtor, broker, a very successful investor. And he came on and said, "Claude, what do you do when you get people on the phone who want to talk for 90 minutes? What do you do? What do you do with them?"
I have that.
You did?
What? Yeah.
What? And you're nice and polite, and you stay on with an hour, hour and a half, 2 hours with them, right?
Wasting time.
Are you a nice person, Lynn?
Too nice.
Oh, good. Let's work on that a little. What happens when we're too nice, too giving? We want to be polite, okay?
People take advantage.
Too much. People take. You're right, Helen. They take advantage of you, of your good nature. If you're
too giving. Your contractor doesn't return your phone calls.
Yes, how do I know?
In the sales, but is it good to be a little bit direct or assertive, or let people know that you're busy, that you have other appointments, you have other clients, that your time is valuable? Is that being abrasive a little bit? Is that a little being a little too nasty?
No.
Your time is valuable just like theirs.
Oh, but Mr. Kennedy, role play, Kerry. Oh, Mr. Okay. Kennedy, I have so many questions. I'm so interested in your property and everything. And I got to work out this spreadsheet and make sure all the numbers work and everything. I'm very interested in it, though. Just one or two more questions.
Sure. What do you got?
Okay, boom. I've been already 45 minutes on the phone. What does every person who wants to keep you on the phone say, Bill Pinnell?
They'll say, "Hey, I just have one more question. Can I?" Can I ask you one more, and then I'll let you go.
Don't they all do that? Do they go to school for that? I mean, where do they learn that? And what happens when they say just one more question?
It turns into three or four more.
Okay. Or the what's the other thing they say? Oh, can I have just another minute of your time?
Right.
The replays of Columbo have taught us that.
Yeah. Oh, Columbo. Tell everybody about Columbo. What did he do? Who remembers Peter Falk, right?
Yes. Yeah.
Does anybody remember this? Go back? What is that, the 60s?
70s.
70s. Tell everybody he was a detective. Was Peter Falk. His hair looked like mine, but messier. He wore this wrinkly raincoat in Los Angeles. I got to tell you something. I've lived in California for 35 years. Nobody wears a raincoat in Los Angeles.
Certain people do, but that's all they have on.
and then he would go. He'd have the murder in the room. He was really smart, but he played a little bit of a dummy. Do you think sometimes we should play a dummy when we're talking to people? I don't understand. Ben Jasso, I don't understand. Could you help me out? What did you mean by that? I'm all confused here. I know I'm the salesman and I'm supposed to have all the answers, but could you help me out? I'm just so lost here right now, buddy.
I speak to so many people like yourself, and what's the difference, Claude? You know, what are you going to do for me?
Yeah, and that was Columbo. He'd play like he was dumb, but he really wasn't dumb. And then he'd leave the room. Oh, just one more question, right? Mm-hmm. And that's when the prospect or the suspect, the murderer, would just feel overconfident. and they'd make a mistake or they'd give information. Isn't sales a little like that? Should we have all the answers to all the questions that the prospect asks, or should we turn a question into a question like Columbo did?
Question into a question.
Why? Why is, isn't that annoying though?
No, you can finesse, you lull them in and they reveal themselves.
Ooh, say that again. That was brilliant, Ben.
You lull them in and they reveal themselves. They're not intimidated because you're not barking at them. You're kind of lost and they're, you know, and they get to it.
What happens when you get into that conversation with that prospect and you say, could you give me, I want to help you solve this problem. I know you're trying to buy, sell, invest, or whatever you're trying to do. I know you're looking for an opportunity. Could you mind if I take some notes? Could you tell me exactly what you're looking for? What would it take for you to make a commitment or move forward? I just want to learn more about what your needs are. Do you mind if I take, Ben, do you mind if I take some notes?
No, go ahead.
Okay, could you share with me what you're looking for, what your budget is? When, you don't want to take action right away. Could you share some idea, what your thoughts are with me? What's your opinion?
We do. We've got to get going.
What am I doing here right now? Am I selling and giving this long-winded intellectual presentation? What am I getting the prospect to do?
Talking.
Say again?
Talking.
Talking. Talking about what? Revealing things?
About their needs.
Ooh, very good. Their needs, their budget, their time frame, their motivation. Are they the decision maker or how they make decisions? When you get the prospect talking more than you and they give you great information, doesn't that tell you how to sell them, how to close them?
Yeah.
Is this kind of the secret sauce of guts? Yeah. Get the prospect talking more than, did anyone see I got out the notepad, by the way. Why do I do that?
You want to write it down.
I want to write it down, but why? Everything I do is for a reason, a psychological reason, to make a stroking, nurturing empathy. Why? When you go to somebody, oh, Helen, I say that. Oh, Helen, these are great ideas. Oh, thank. Could you give me your opinion? I want to write this down, Helen. What am I doing?
Yes, as soon as you put it on the paper, it's more valuable.
Right. What's going on to your with your ego right now? And Helen, this is great information. Oh,
this person's working on my behalf.
Okay. What do you think what do you think her feelings are for me when I say, oh, thank you for this. This is such,
paying attention.
You're making my job so easy.
Paying attention to me.
You're also right.
You're making her feel good because you're telling her that what she's saying is important.
Bailey, brilliant.
For your writing
and you're working for me. You're working for my needs.
I'm working for you. And what Bailey said, I'm making you feel good. What happens when we meet a person, a stranger, in business, in social, and they make you feel good? It sounds so simple, but how big is this in persuading somebody to your product, your service, your ideology? How important? It's huge.
It is.
It's huge.
How many of us take the time and trouble in business or anything to make somebody else feel good?
I do.
It's nice. How do you do that, Jessica? Give me an example or something.
I think just show genuine interest in their circumstance, their challenge, and really offer a solution. That's what sales ultimately is. I think when you're providing a solution for a problem, then you're really you're helping them, you're making money yourself, and it's like a win-win, but you're genuinely interested in making their life better. That's what I think.
I was a little quick story here, just a little. It's amazing to me. I'm always interacting with people because I want to practice all the time. I even have a mind map. I think, I don't know if I showed it to you. How to engage people. I'll show it to you in a second. I was on a chair. I went skiing on Saturday. It was a brilliant 32 degree day here. Fresh snow, Colorado blue sky. Okay. And so I go skiing for about 3 hours, and there was this 84-year-old man on the chairlift. And someone's got background noise here. Doors closing and things like that. Okay, mute yourself if you have background noise for the sake of everyone else. So this is a sweet old guy. I'm sorry?
Okay. Sorry.
I'm just going to have to mute a few people here. I'm sorry. I'm just getting this background stuff. So anyway, he said, I am lost. He says, I, because it's a monstrous ski area. It's like five mountains and the chairlifts go all over the place. And it's really easy to get lost here. And, you know, your car might be on one mountain and you're four mountains away. Okay. And some chairlifts, because they're high up, they shut down at 3:30 and everything. And he said, I need to, I said, you know what? It's okay. I'm going there anyway. I'll show you where to go, what chairlift to go. So we're skiing and I'm going real slow. This old guy is passing me. Okay. this man was born with skis on and everything. So I got him to the right chairlift. We rode up again to the chairlift and everything like that. He says, thank you so much. It's so nice of you. Can I buy you a beer? Because we were by the lodge and everything. I said, you know, it's like how to make an instant friend. Okay. It just by helping somebody or talking to them or something like that. In business, it's the same thing. Just these little things that happen to me on a daily basis. I think they're so important in business. Absolutely. Open forum time. Before I show you mind maps and my keynote and how I do some marketing, does anybody else have a question, a role play, or did anyone make money last week or have a good sale?
I bought a house last week, I guess.
Let's go. Turn on your video and show us the chihuahuas and tell us about it. There he is.
What's up, guys?
Hey, how are you, Alex?
Alex, man, I got COVID. I got COVID, but I'm good.
Oh no!
Oh no!
Whoa!
Yeah.
Cute. But,
oh, yeah, cute. I got COVID. Anyway, I got COVID on Saturday, and I worked. Yeah, I worked out on Sunday and today, and I already feel 90%. So if you're sick, definitely work out. I'm not a doctor, but that definitely helps.
Should we all put on face masks right now, or?
I would. Shit, I would. You might get a virus on your computer unless you got a mask.
No computer virus. So even though you were, well, I hope you feel better and everything like that. Tell us about your deal.
Yeah, so, you know, it was a deal where, you know, a guy was going through a pending problem. He's going through foreclosure. So contacted him, told him how I could help and made it easy for him. Told him, you know what, I'll give you a certain amount of money. You know, we'll close on this day and I'll hire the movers, take what you want, pack up what you want, leave what you don't. And that's it. So we closed on Friday and yeah, so bought a house on Friday. So that was cool.
So was this one phone call or a series of calls or?
Well, this is my favorite, but not everyone's favorite, door knocking. So I got this one off of door knocking.
You really got this. I have such respect for somebody who can door knock. I mean, don't you meet people who don't like you or slam the door or have their pit bull on the short leash and things like
sometimes,
that?
Sometimes. And sometimes, you know, never make assumptions. Just like calling. I get people who make me food all the time.
Sometimes they invite you in and make you food.
Yeah, I get food all the time. I don't always eat the food because I'm like, it's kind of sketchy in here. But anyway.
I've got a lot of and how many doors did you have to knock on till you found this one deal?
Probably less than 30.
Okay. The round of applause for that, man. I tell you, it takes a lot of you know, my mom said, don't talk to strangers. And here you're going out knocking on doors during COVID days. Okay. I got a lot of respect for that. You're not going to make, so you met this person at the door. What was the sequence of events? You followed up obviously, or sent a contract.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Set the expectations, said, hey, you know, we're going to close and, you know, this is the terms of the contract. I need it back by this time. And me and him just went over it and it was good to go. Yeah.
Okay.
Just so making it easy, making it simple. Yeah.
You make it sound too easy here. There had to be a little, so what is this, a cash deal, a lease purchase, a wholesale? What is this?
this is going to be a purchase where I'm acquiring it with a fix and flip loan, and then I'll refinance it and keep it.
Oh, it's a keeper.
Yeah, this is a keeper. This is a good one.
What's the location, city and state? Where are you at?
Golden, Colorado, where they make Coors beer.
I love Gold. Tell everybody, Golden is one of the most beautiful little, it's a cute little Colorado city. I think it has the College of Mines there. Am I right? And it has a really prominent college there. Has a little river that goes through the town, and people go inner tubing on the river during the summer. It is one of the cutest little, it is a great little town.
Yeah.
And you just knocked on doors and found a motivated seller?
Yeah, absolutely.
You're making it sound too easy. Did you? So you talked with the, what was their level of motivation?
They were pretty high. I mean, if you're going to knock pre-foreclosures, I mean, I knew that he had a dismissed bankruptcy, so it's kind of advanced, right?
Okay.
Yeah, so his bankruptcy didn't go through. So when you know that someone's bankruptcy doesn't go through and it's dismissed, they can't file bankruptcy again. Obviously, I'm not an attorney or anything, but generally speaking, if someone files bankruptcy and they fail their payment plan, more than likely they can't file bankruptcy again. So you let them know that they essentially they have the option to sell or do nothing. If they do nothing, they might not get any money. If they sell, they'll make some money and avoid foreclosure.
Okay. Can you share a few numbers with us and what you're projecting on this thing? And is there any fix up or anything? You're going to rent?
Yeah. So I got it at about 165 and I'm going to probably put 80,000 into it.
You don't mind if I take notes, do you?
Can I ask a question? How did you find out about his history that was going on with him? Where did you get that information from about the foreclosures and everything? Or
just the county recorder. Through the county recorder, you can essentially pull a report and see all the, you know, the liens that they have, outstanding things, something with the city, you know, mortgages, past debts, all that stuff.
That's all public information, right? Okay.
Okay. So using my fingers and toes and my New York City education here, you got it for 165. You project 80,000 in repairs. You said that's 245,000.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
If I'm right. What's this? What do you think the street value will be once it's fixed up?
Probably around 400, 410.
Okay. Is that based on comps in the neighborhood?
Yeah.
Okay, so that's a potential of $155,000 potential profit.
Yeah,
on one deal, that's a year's salary plus, isn't it?
Did you buy it subject to the existing financing?
Not this one. I've done sub twos before, but no, I just bought this one straight up.
Okay,
you borrow hard money. You use hard money for that.
Yeah, I used, if you guys want my link, I'll send it to you. Kiavi, they're okay, right? They're 1% origination and like 8.5% for repairs. Or excuse me, 8.5%, they'll fund 90% of the purchase price and 100% of the repairs.
Can you put it in the chat box there?
Yeah, I'll do that.
Okay, how do you spell that? Maybe I'll do it for you. How do you spell that?
Now, I'll find it because I have a link that gives you $500 off and it gives me $500.
Okay. So yeah. Put that in there right now. That'd be great.
Okay.
On that. So you have someone else's money. You have to put up 10%, which to me is like 16.5, if I'm reading that correctly.
Yep.
Okay. And closing costs. So you're 20,000 into this deal that can give you a yield of 155, but you're going to keep it. Or probably once you get it fixed, are you going to get a construction loan so you can take the money out of the equity or?
Yeah. So I have a construction. So I have an acquisition rehab loan right now, and that's good for a year. But once that's completed, I'll just use my taxes and I'll do a refinance probably in March and then just keep the property myself.
Okay.
Conventional bank.
Yeah. Conventional bank. Yeah, exactly.
So you're going to refi it. You're going to replace the hard money loan for one that's 165 and recoup all or a portion of your 80,000 investment.
Yeah, and probably keep a couple of, and probably keep a little bit of money. So I'm going to pay myself to
You're going to put 10, 20, so you're going to replace everything with a single conservative mortgage, 3.5, 4% or whatever it goes up, whatever it goes up to. And then put 10, 20, 30,000 in your pocket at the same time.
Yep, exactly.
Isn't that fun? But getting a property now, and then I'm sorry to pick your brain here, but I love stories like this. So then you're going to rent it out or do an Airbnb or what, or lease purchase? What's your thought thinking?
Yeah, I'll rent that one out. I also have one in Inglewood that I'm purchasing in 2 weeks that I'm doing an Airbnb with. Same thing.
Let's talk about finish this one. What do you think the market rent is on this property fixed up?
Wow. Probably close to 2,300.
Okay. And what do you think your mortgage, your principal, interest, taxes, insurance, homeowner fees, whatever, do you think it'll be break even or you'll have a couple hundred?
Oh, no, it'll be about $1,200 for principal, interest, taxes, and insurance. And then the HOA is $300. So I'm looking at about $1,500 right there.
Okay. So $1,500. So if a rent is $2,300, let's say, so you stand to make $500 to $800 a month, roughly.
Yeah, after my property management fee, yeah, probably about $700 a month.
Okay, and then you can depreciate this on your taxes and everything else.
Yep.
And you have an equity position on this property of at least $150,000.
Yep, you got it.
That deserves a round of applause. Thank you for letting me break it down. I like to know this. Carrie Kennedy.
Yeah, absolutely.
Harry Kennedy, are you happy with that story? I know you love real estate stories.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, that was a good story. Could you share? I love that you guys are doing Airbnbs right now. Could you just, if you feel up to it, Alex, I know you don't feel well, tell us the Airbnb story on the other property.
Oh, yeah. So So this one's off of a cold call. So I called up the guy and asked what was going on. Ended up talking to a gentleman who was in his 80s and started asking him questions. And I was like, is there anybody else that maybe can help with the situation? And he called over his son, and his son was the personal representative of the property in which I was calling on. And just asked him about it. And we went out to I met him at the property to take a look. And I asked him what his number was, and he said that he had somebody who told him, $150,000 was the offer. And I said, hey, I could do that and I'll pay the closing costs. So that's how I arrived on the number with that one.
So by sweetening the deal, by picking up the closing costs, $3,000 to $5,000?
Yep.
That was the closing?
Making it easy. I even put in the contract as one of the additional provisions that I will make it seamless and easy for the seller.
Okay. That's what we call blue sky. That's when you make promises that are really not enforceable.
That's true. Well, I also hire movers, and I let people take what they want, leave what they don't. A lot of people don't do that for some reason. They just say as is, but
that's interesting. Huh? How do you intertwine throwing in the movers? What does that sound like?
Yeah. So I'll be like, this is going to be an all cash offer. A lot of people will tell you as is, but they'll just give you a bag of money and tell you to figure it out. Mm-hmm. So that's something I don't do. Imagine for a moment, you get all the money that you want and that we agree on. You don't have to pay for any repairs. I'll schedule the movers and I'll pay for 3 months worth of storage for you. Would that be something that would allow you to be free from this? And people say, yeah, all the time.
Love that.
That's a cherry on top of the Sunday offer. That's great.
See, it's like problem solving. You're solving their problems. You're taking their worries away and serving them as well. That's good.
Did anybody hear a special word that Alex used? Did anyone pick up that word he was using in his role play before?
Imagine for a moment.
Imagine for a moment. We did the storage. We did the moving. It would be seamless. What happens when you
gotta call that the John Lennon technique?
Okay.
Imagine.
Yeah. When you use that word to people, it kind of gets a thought, a storybook, a movie going on in their head. Absolutely. So what are you going to do with this property? You said you're going to make it into an Airbnb.
Yep. So I'm going to acquire this the same way with a construction rehab loan. And then I will then just refinance it and be able to keep it. Now, this one is going to be a little bit different. I have a private non-owner occupied lender. So someone that will essentially lend on non-owner occupied LLC ownership properties. And he loans it about like 1 to 1.5% over the prime rate, which is really good.
What do you think? What do the numbers look like on the Airbnb? Is that a weekend, a weekly? This is in Golden. So this is a property. Who are your guests for the summer? Is this mostly a summer attraction property, or people whose kids going to the college or something like that? Or
the secondary one that I was talking about with the personal representative and all that, that's in a southern area of Denver. And so that's where Airbnb is allowed. So it's near, you know, downtown Denver. It's near a hospital. It's near like a concert hall and stuff like that. So it's near all that.
Okay. And what do you think it? What's your projection? What will it generate? What do you think it'll generate for you, passive income wise?
Passive income, it'll probably be around 400 on a low end to, you know, about probably like 1500 on a good month. After all expenses and everything else.
Okay, beautiful. Beautiful. Can you do that on the Golden property too?
I'm going to have to look into that because it's technically a townhouse, the one in Golden. So I don't know if the HOA is going to allow for it.
Okay. Thanks for, you're on, for a guy who's not feeling too well, you're on fire right now, man.
the reason is because I have another property, and I know you told me not to do it, but I have a property out. I went to, I flew 1500 miles to try to talk to one of my sellers.
You got on the WOSIC International Airlines, right?
Yeah. So,
Where did you fly?
In Hawaii?
I went to West Virginia.
Hmm. Okay. So you got a bottle of Jack Daniels when you landed.
It was pretty bad. So I have a guy who's out in, so the property's out in the west side of Denver. And I got it under contract back in October. And when he sent me the key and the contract, I went to go look at it and I was like, there's two cars here. What's going on? Well, there's people that are smoking, selling, and doing crack in the house. Oh. And he doesn't know who those people are. This guy's in like his 70s. And long story short, we're going to go through the whole eviction process, but Denver's pretty non-owner friendly. You got to be the owner, right? I was going to say they're super liberal, but that's just 70 year old.
What's a 70-year-old crackhead look like? Oh my God.
There is actually an older crackhead guy that's in there. Yeah, he doesn't have any teeth. He looks like he likes applesauce, to be honest. So there's these people that are stuck in the property. I haven't heard from the seller since the last week of November, and his phone went dead. And long story short, I went out there. I tried to do a welfare check on him. He was okay. This was mid-December, and so I haven't heard anything. So I went out there, and come to find out, he died on the day that I got there, which was crazy.
Now, you are a motivational speaker, aren't you?
But check this out. I knew that he loved Budweiser, so it was all worth it because I knew he loved Budweiser. And I left him a little suitcase of Budweiser with a note on top of it. And guess who found that note? His girlfriend and his sister. So they're next in line on the property. They live in West Virginia. They don't want anything to do with it. So if I wouldn't have gone out there and he would have, you know, passed away, I probably wouldn't have been able to get a hold of them. But now I have the contact info for them. So I'm massaging that one through and hopefully going to be able to flip or do something with that one. So
why did I tell you not to fly out there? I wonder why.
Yeah,
you have a lucky horseshoe over your head, don't you?
Well, it's because I believe in myself. You know, I believe in myself more than anybody else will. And so I give my myself permission to do crazy shit, so I don't live with regret. Whereas a lot of other people are like my parents are like, you're flying, you're gonna spend like $1,000 to go across the country to go try to maybe talk to them. I'm like, what's the cost to me not going there? So yeah. Maybe I'm crazy, maybe I'm not. Who knows?
I want to do you have a
roll the dice.
Say that again, Jessica.
You gotta roll the dice, you gotta play to win, right? You gotta be in the game to win.
Yeah, but what are the odds of, you know, you got to have some reasonable odds in your favor. I commend you. I think it's wonderful. I'd like to see a picture of the case of Budweiser in the suitcase, though. Do you have a picture of that?
Yeah.
We got to call this the Budweiser close technique. We've got to do a mind map on this. Sometimes doing these little gestures, little thoughtful things, right? You know, somebody bring them beer, give them a gift card to the Pizza Hut or something, or a gift card to the, hey, do you like coffee? Let me get you a Starbucks gift card if we could have another appointment or conversation. You know, rewarding people with a small token of appreciation.
Yes.
Sometimes is a great way, you know, because why do people pick us over somebody else? Why is Alex doing all these deals? You know, why is he able to connect with people when so many other people are struggling and getting frustrated? What's he doing special?
He'll go the extra mile for someone. He'll make them feel he understands what their problems are and he tries to solve them. So
Exactly. Well, Mike, Alex, nice going, man. Thanks for sharing all that. That was wonderful. That was great. Carrie, Mr. Kennedy, I have a picture. Long as we were talking about Airbnbs, can I show the picture of your Airbnb?
Sure.
Okay.
Absolutely.
Can I share
this? Can I ask Alex one question?
Sure.
Yeah. What part of West Virginia did you fly to?
Oh, my. So I flew into Knoxville, Tennessee, and then we drove all the way up and we ended up outside of Morgantown.
Okay. I was born and raised in West Virginia. That's in the Upper Panhandle. That's where West Virginia University is.
Yes, sir. It is.
Yeah.
Okay.
Good. Good for you.
Nice going. Long as we were talking, yeah. I'm kind of fascinated by people who are buying properties, financing them, like Alex, like Carrie does, and rehabbing them, and then turning them into little mini hotels, the Airbnb. What's the name of the other organization? VOI something?
VRBO.
VRBO.
Turbo.
Yeah.
Yeah. And here, can you, is that the property, Carrie?
That's the one.
That's the one. Let me see if I can enlarge it for you guys on there. Okay. Why don't you tell us, can you tell us a little bit about that property, Carrie?
Sure. It's two bedrooms, two baths with a loft. It's about 1,600 square feet. I think it's from construction. We bought that about a year and a half ago. We recently redid the lower deck. We put in the lower deck with the steps and then the two retaining walls.
Is that this part here?
Yep.
Okay.
Yep. And so we did that about a month ago. We paid $192 for it. You know, we're getting, between $4,000 and $5,000 a month.
Wait, whoa. Let me look you in the eye when you say that. I'm going to give you two martinis and a shot of sodium pentothal. What did you just say?
$4,000 to $5,000 a month.
How do you sleep at night? Why is that area? Where was that area again? I'm sorry. Was that North Carolina?
That is actually in Banner Elk, North Carolina, which is like a stone's throw from Boone, North Carolina, with all the skiing. A lot of the skiing. Wineries. You know, it's a very, people come. 365 days a year. You know, because they have stuff, you know, they have Grandfather Mountain, they have Tweetsie Railroad, you know, they have the skiing shops, all kinds of stuff. And, you know, the area, you know, we moved there full time about 6 months ago. you know, because we moved from Columbia, South Carolina, and we moved there full time. And I mean, it's growing. Prices are crazy. So, you know, that one's done really, really well.
So when you were looking for properties, did you know instantly that this that you were going to make this into a overnight accommodation, an Airbnb kind of place, or did that evolve? Well,
the plan was to make that an Airbnb because we're there, you know, half part of the year, you know, we live there, you know, half of the year, and then we go somewhere else the other part of the year, and I want to make money while I'm not there.
Okay.
And so that one's, you know, done really well. You know, we get bookings every day. I mean, we got one for a couple of days ago for June. We're getting them for September. People are booking like a year out, which I'm really surprised at that. But, you know, but that particular, all our guests say they love that house because it's in the middle of everything. And I just kind of guessed with that particular development, you know, we put the offer in on the house, and we got the house, and I said, hey, I'll see if this Airbnb thing works. And it's just, I mean, it's stayed rented. I mean, it's always rented when we're not there. And you know, we're trying to find something else because, you know, we want to make that one into like a full-time one because it's doing so well.
And you manage, how does this, who does the cleaning between guests and the management and everything? How does that work real quick?
We have like three different housekeepers that we keep on this schedule. My wife takes care of that, just getting, you know, they get a copy of the monthly schedule. They know when to go. And then I pay them through Venmo, PayPal. And the Airbnb does all the bookings, they pay the taxes, and they collect the money.
And you probably have a high rating. They Airbnb is based on reviews and comments and stuff like that. How do you get good reviews?
About a couple of months ago, you know, we're a super host now. So, you know, you start, and then, you know, based on your bookings, you know, good reviews, 5-star reviews. And after a certain amount of time, Airbnb will review you. And if you pass their criteria, they'll make you a super host. From then on, you have to get that super host rating.
So 4,000 to 5,000 a month. That's a retirement income. That's one property, one deal with a little smart marketing. And you pick the right location, obviously.
Airbnb does all the marketing because, you know, you see Airbnb, you know, national ads on the TV all the time. So I don't have to do any marketing. They do it all.
Wow. That another round of applause, man. That is fantastic. So this one property brings in 50,000-60,000 a year. And it's automatic. It's on an automatic one deal. That to me is amazing to me because you hear a lot of the gurus. Oh, I did 30 deals before breakfast today and everything like that. You know, and you guys know what I'm thinking right now when I hear stuff like that. But here's a guy who did one deal, same like Alex, one good deal with the right location, the right understanding of the numbers and the marketing. Whether it's a rental or an Airbnb or something. Last question, can you do VRBO and Airbnb simultaneously, or are there restrictions? You can one or the other.
Yes, because Airbnb, they have this function where Airbnb and VRBO, they will sync calendars. So when VRBO books something, Airbnb can't, you know, because they sync the calendars.
Okay. Okay. Well, are you going to do more of these? I mean, do you like it so much that you see yourself doing another one?
Yeah, I got to finish this flip first and then we're in the process of buying something else. Plus I was looking at that quad that I showed you the other day in those mobile homes and that house. So just, you know, whatever comes first.
That's where I think the That's where I think the buy and hold strategy can be such a great one. It's not that big, huge ward all at once, but it gives you that residual income going on and on and on and on. So yeah, it's great.
I mean, I get paid every 2 to 3 days.
Yeah.
And it will be more than when I, you know, when I had the rentals, and you'd get, you know, you get one check, you get $700 positive cash flow, and yeah, then that's it. But with these Airbnb, you know, with the Airbnb, you get paid every two to three days.
Wow.
And so it just, but yeah, I mean, that property's done really, really well.
I guess it really depends on your perspective or where you are getting into the business. Do you need, do you have limited resources, income and credit? Are you just getting started where you want to do a quick deal, turn it over to somebody else, make some money, build up your capital reserves so that eventually you can do what Alex and Carrie are doing? You need, you know, so you could build it up. I mean, that's truly being in control of your own investments. Mm-hmm. Okay. Nothing against the stock market or Bitcoin and everything. But when we hear about deals like this, these people get paid directly. They don't have to wait for somebody else to give them money, and they don't have to, and they're in control of their income, of their money. Doesn't that make a lot of sense?
Yes.
I think so. Good. I love these stories, guys. Thanks for sharing that. That's wonderful. I wanted to share something here before we run out of time. Just something I do in terms of marketing. Alex knocks on doors. Carrie works with realtors. I do attraction marketing. Let me share my screen with you guys. Here. I like doing, I do, as you know, I do mind maps. I make up, here's one. Did I show you guys this mind map last week or a week before? Anybody?
Yes.
Okay. These are little mind maps I use. I use a system called MindNode. This is on rehearsing spontaneity, how to speak to people. Here's another one I did recently. I haven't shown you this. I'll probably use it next week. Phone prospecting solution and system. What the technology, what's the logic, the system, what do I use when I get on the phone with people? That's a mind map. We'll probably see that next week. Here is one, I don't know if I shared this with you on marketing, on that. And I take these mind maps and then I put them and I make them on MindNode, as I said, and then I use something called Keynote on there. And Keynote, basically I can, and this is what I used the other day. I just take all those mind maps and I put them into this key. How many people, if you have a Mac, it's called Keynote. It's the easiest thing in the world to set up. You can just literally drag slides over and around real easy. You can insert videos here. Here's one of my favorite videos. I've shown it to you before, opposite George from Seinfeld. You can put pictures in there. All kinds of, I can add in my mind maps. I can do my rule of five. This is my, here's one. Here's a really good mind map on attraction marketing. Here's another one on the rules of guts. And while I'm giving the presentation, I can expand or move them around or anything, or I can click on them. I have notes that are attached to it. And this is, I use this in front of audiences. In person when we could. Here's another video that I use. Change your words, change everybody. Has everyone ever seen this video before? It's on YouTube, it's fantastic. And here's probably one of the most important things I do. Whenever I speak to after I make these mind maps and I set up my PowerPoint, or I use Mac, which is Keynote, I always give something away for free. I'll give away free mind maps or keynotes. Why do I do that?
Because you can't withdraw from an account.
I did a keynote yesterday to the Los Angeles Real Estate Club. And this morning I checked my email, because yesterday was a crazy Sunday. And I have 5 people out of that group who contacted me. One of them I have an appointment with on real estate, and another one wants information on my programs. That is all from just using that little keynote. How easy does it make it when you're speaking in front of a group and you have that keynote? Is that like a working outline that you can work off of?
Yeah.
How easy? So if you get in front of a group, a Kiwanis, a Lions Club, a Chamber of Commerce, a real estate club, a business group, anybody here ever go to meetup.com? You want to get, okay, you go locally, go check out your local, go to meetup.com. And in your area, I guarantee you there are real estate clubs, business clubs, sales, all kinds of organizations that relate to, they are your customers or future prospects. And if you contact those people and you say, hey, I'd like to speak to your group, and you can do it on Zoom. Everybody knows Zoom now. We're all used to using it. And you set up a little PowerPoint or keynote with a couple mind maps and pictures and maybe some videos that you copied and posted from YouTube. And now you have a whole presentation. You can do 10 slides, which will give you all the talking points or bullet points for a presentation. And you can do this for podcasts. You can do it for live streaming. You can do it for clubs or organizations, meetup.com. You can contact RIAs and organizations. Every time you promote yourself or speak to a group, this starts ringing. People email you and contact you with deals. And this is the marketing that I do. And I do this every week. I spend 30 to 60 minutes a day putting out original content about topics that relate to the business that I'm in. Does that make sense? Is that something you guys can do? What do you guys mm-hmm. think about that? That is the kind of marketing that really makes it work so well. And you're getting in those warm leads. So if you don't want to knock on doors, if you don't want to make cold calls all day, isn't it better to attract people into your world mm-hmm. that you can speak with and just stay a lot more relaxed, comfortable, and confident? That's basically my marketing method. And those are the two, and I also use Zoom as much as possible. When you get a phone, when someone emails you, send them a Zoom invitation or a link. Get them face-to-face, or use your iPhone for FaceTime, or use Facebook for Messenger. The more people, it always goes back to that rule of five. Can we speak to a couple people today? Cold calls, warm calls, follow-up calls. Call up realtors. Hey, do you have any deals for me? Can you find me a deal? Do you have any motivated sellers? Are we speaking to people every day? Can you spend 30 to 60 minutes a day speaking to people? What do you think about that, Lynn?
Definitely a skill I gotta get better at.
Oh, it's a skill. Believe me, I'm the former world's worst salesman. Now I'm a big mouth, okay? I found that I could get comfortable. My daughter gave me the greatest compliment ever. She said, Dad, you're just comfortable in your own skin. It took me such a long time to get here. It really did. And you're listening to these other people here. Kai, come on. Being more outgoing or flipping the switch is so important. Oh, we've got a celebrity. We've got a famous person on here. Jack, turn on your video. I got Winter Park Jack on here. This is an interesting man. If I can get him to turn on his video. Let's see.
Video.
Turn on that video. There he is. Look at that picture back. Okay, that's your Mount Everest picture, Jack. Do you guys want to, this guy is one of the most successful real estate. He's a real estate broker. He's an entrepreneur. Can I talk a little bit about you, Jack, while you're trying to figure out how to turn on your camera?
Please go ahead.
Okay, Jack is one of, up here in Colorado. Jack and his partner owned basically all the ski shops in the town. And I believe, did you sell, and you sold them to a large a corporation or something at one time, didn't you?
No, that was the little company, Vail.
Yeah, a little company called Vail. Yeah.
So let's see there. Maybe I'll come on now.
There you are. Go. Yay.
Yeah.
How you doing, Jack?
Well, I would have been on earlier. I walked out to get my headset and the puppy took off.
Jack,
so I
Jack.
Give me a Kleenex.
Yes.
Give me a Kleenex.
Maybe get out my boohoo tissues here. Jack is Jack. Jack's you sold your business. Jack is you've been to Tibet twice. He is attempted to climb Mount Everest twice, more than I'll ever do. Wow. Missed it by that much, right, Jack?
Just by 1,000 feet. That's it.
Yeah. Wow. How many people knows here somebody who has attempted attempted to climb Mount Everest? Okay. No. This is an interesting mess. And then you got into real estate, right, Jack?
I did.
Yeah. Can you tell everybody a little bit about that? What you're doing out here in Colorado? What's going on in Colorado right now?
The market. I called Claude yesterday because I was pulling my hair out. Qualifying people. We're in a very, very hot market. You know, it's all second homes. You know, for me, it's 99% second homes. The market is got two switches and they're both on full speed. You know, things come on Thursday, probably like where you guys are at.
When you first came here, what did a condo go for in Colorado, in a ski area, in Winter Park, Colorado?
It had to be 30 grand, 40 grand. And today they're 400.
Starting.
Or more, yeah. You know, we're seeing, you know, our building costs are in excess of 500 to 1,000. The prices are just staggering, but what I'm seeing in the market. And this was like over the top yesterday, you know, as far as dealing with a couple of buyers. Get hold of me right away. I'm qualified. I want this condo. Let's go. And I do it. And then the guy is like, oh, the numbers don't work. And yeah, you put a lot of time into it. It's like, duh, you're not, you know, you're looking at a $900,000 condo. You want to get the condo on short-term rental. Most everything here is STR, you know, short-term rental. And I want to use it when I can, and I want to use it as an investment property. And the numbers just don't work to float the boat for mortgage, property taxes, insurance, and the split with the management company. So anyway, you know, it's the same story. We hear the same five questions all the time, whatever business we're in.
What do you see as the highest price? What do you see the highest priced homes being built right now in this sleepy little town? Former sleepy little town.
Well, you know, Brad Smith with Terra Firma, I think he's quoting somewhere around $750 a foot to build.
Wow.
That's not land cost. That's stick stones, material, management, architecture.
Wow. What's the highest price? What's the highest listed home you've seen so far up in the mountains?
36 million.
Over by
Kremlin.
36 million. It's amazing. How long is this going to, what do you see us into 2022? Do you see this continuing or
flattening out? I think we may see a little bit of a slowdown, interest rates, rising prices, but I don't see anything that's going on. I don't see, unless, you know, a friend of mine runs appraisal for Chase. So she sees a different picture. And what they're telling her is this market is not going to stop unless we get into some kind of war, you know, and I don't think Biden's going to pull the trigger on getting us really into, that kind of confrontation with Ukraine and the Soviets. The pandemic thing is starting to settle down. They're going to do away this week with mask requirements in Denver. So, you know, I don't know where you guys are at, but in all the resorts, the gap for affordability for a guy that teaches skiing, carpenter, tradesperson, for they to be able to afford a home, if they can find one to rent, it is a teeny tiny amount of availability of rental homes for workforce, because VRBO, Airbnb, I can make so much more money renting it short term as
we were just long. We were just talking about it. The fellow above you, Mr. Kennedy, I think he said he's making $4,000 or $5,000 a month on an Airbnb in North Carolina. Alex over there, who lives in Denver, he's working on an Airbnb right now from Golden or downtown Denver, he said. That seems to be a real passive income moneymaker going on right now.
Well, I think it's all dollars and cents, you know. If you're financing it, I don't know, you know, but if you got a high amount of equity into it, it's just dollars and cents.
Absolutely.
So that's one way of solving the problem with the cash flow, isn't it? To put a little bit more money down if people have it, and then they can buy a really good, stable investment and it'll still cash flow, but they've got more equity invested. So.
Right. It's just dollars and cents, you know, as far as what your income is, you know, if you're, you know, the formula of mortgage, HOA, property taxes, you know, management company. I don't see it. That formula was broken a long time ago. And, you know, there was, and what I'm seeing too is the amount, the volume of STRs. And one time there weren't a lot out there, and now
short-term rentals.
Yeah, there's an abundance of them. So I gotta believe that the competition within that industry is weakening the cash flow side of it.
Jack,
that's as a two bedroom, two bath. But you know, single family homes are doing better.
Jack, we're out of time here. One last quick question: if you had to start all over again, this is a loan. Somebody's got making noise in the background. Okay. Jack, if you had to start all over again, what would you do today? You're 21 years old. You're starting from scratch. What do you think you'd go into? What would you do different, or would you do it all the same?
No, I'd do it different. Yeah, I mean, if we knew then what we know today, right?
Yeah.
What I did is I got tied down when I was 23 to a ski business, and I had responsibilities, so it didn't allow me to do, you know, I had a lot of freedom, and then I created a...
How many shops did you have?
We were up to, you know, it varied between 4 and 6. So, but anyway, if I were to do things over again, I would be more exploratory of the mountains and where to land. It's been really good here, but you know, maybe I would have been real estate from the get-go and not have gotten into the ski business. You know, employees, turnover.
was it as bad 25 years ago as it is today?
I don't think it was as bad, but you know, I was dealing with employee housing issues 25 years ago, so we went out and bought some, which is a challenge to, you know, be the employer, the landlord, and
if you were gonna start all over again, you still would be focused on real estate in some fashion.
When I was doing the ski business, I made a lot of money in real estate at that time. So I was able to buy and flip stuff when it was a very rising market.
That's great.
I might have been more focused in real estate.
Jack, if anyone wants to contact you to buy a $35 million property today, how do they get hold of you?
My website, winterparkjack.com.
There you go. That's great. Thanks for popping on, buddy. I invited Jack earlier. He's a busy guy. He's a wealth of information. This is a guy whose brain you might want to pick, but he's going to use guts on you. Just a warning.
After I got off the phone with you earlier today, a client I've been working with, I did the same stuff you were talking about. I'm going, Mike, how old are you? What are you messing around for? Buy the damn home and, you know, have the family over. It was identical. I plagiarized you completely.
Did it work?
It's very engaging. It's, you know, it changed the tonality as opposed to talking about the market and the numbers and here's the situation and you got to come in high. It's like, you know, I have tried to take things to her, you know, right to the heart. You know, I don't know who you guys deal with, but I got oil and gas guys that come out with their Excel spreadsheets. I'm like, throw those away when your heart is going pitter patter through your shirt. That's the right property. And try to make it more emotional, get away from the numbers.
Did everybody hear that? Try to make it more, what was that E word again?
Emotional.
Try to make it more emotional.
You know, and I fell off of it. You try to make it where they can see it, smell it, and taste it, ooh, you know, and talk about, well, how's it going to feel up there in the morning at the top of Parsons Bowl? Getting ready to make your first turns, yeah. Because you live in town, you were able to get up there for some of the first tracks. How'd that feel?
Sell the story, sell the romantic, sell the emotion, and you get their attention.
And I fell away from it.
We all do.
You're bringing me back to it.
Good. Good. Jack, thank you so much. Round of applause, Jack Gerstein, winterparkjack.com. You want to talk, surround yourself with successful people like Jack, and you'll really learn. You want to make money, you want to learn stuff, hang around with people who have the right to teach like Jack. Hey, listen, everybody, long session. Did we learn a few things today?
Yes. Yes.
Well, say it like you mean it, Jessica. Yes.
Heck okay, yeah. Good.
And Suzette Galian gave me a thumbs up. Everybody have a wonderful, safe, healthy week. Alex, take care of yourself.
Okay? Oh, I am. I'm going to make more money and be healthy while having COVID.
I like the order you put that in. That was very good. That was very good. Everybody have a great week. We're going to go out with a little White Snake music here. You know, I love the oldies. Here we go. Have a good week, everybody, and take care. And I'm going to shut off my recording. Stop.